is worthwhile, no question about it. Because that now gives you stereotactic exercising, which means that you are sitting in a machine and you must have seen sci-fi movies. You are exercising in different positions. Now the chair is moving to and fro, it's leaning front to back, and then, you know, according to the gravity eliminated or gravity added, you are exercising specific muscle more. But obviously, common sense that everybody does not have access, everybody cannot go every day, and all of us are not, I mean, though people are aiming to become professional athletes, at the same time, these appliances are not available freely. They are available for the serious athlete, but if somebody is interested, these are the technological advancements. You can isolate one muscle and you can condition it. But honestly speaking, diet has improved, hydration has to be improved. The way the people train for the event, I'll give you a very simple example. You want to run a marathon. Everybody is training every day to run the marathon. The way to do the marathon is you do carbohydrate loading for 7 days before the match. And the day before the marathon itself, you don't run actually. And you store all the glycogen, all the energy in the form of glycogen, which then converts to glucose when you're running, and then your brain and your muscles are utilizing it. If this is not followed, then as marathon, there will be 10 lakh tari astar pachu there. This is hurting and that is hurting. So I do not believe any technological significant advances have been made, but people are now more aware because the athletes, well, the seriousness are like that. Initially, it was a casual approach. Now, with your organizations, you know, working towards it, I'm glad to see that there are more professional athletes which will be churned out in the future, and that's what we need, I guess. And they will also weekend like a lot of people. So, I think these I find are the awareness has become the technological advancement rather than machines, really. And that's what I will focus on. There are so many supplements available, there are drinks available, there are so many enhancement products available. They all have risky, we will come to that later.
Yeah, absolutely. Protein is something that we
have. There are lots of other things which we will dabble in later.
Yeah, so what we see and we've been seeing for a long time is the magic spray. Any injury, anything you see, the physio coming in, putting the magic spray on, getting things ready. So I've heard a lot, we've heard a lot saying that the magic spray is not advisable. It said you should not put the magic spray right on the wound or the spray. So we just wanted to know how exactly is it advisable to put the magic spray on as soon as there's a wound? Is that the way that works for an injury?
If an athlete has to complete and his team needs it, then they need to use the spray, whatever the contents of the spray. But if you ask me, it is the athlete should attack. Should not get a heal. Because see, if you have got an injury and you still are straining that muscle or whatever it or ligament, you are bound to increase the injury more. See, once you're injured, it takes some amount of time for that part to recover. You are not getting that part to recover. As I said before, you are trying to become something which you are not. So the healing process, if you see the healing process, it's a chain of events. Mm-hmm. Okay, if you try to break that chain of events, you try to make it fast, it has to have an after effect. Like some other metabolite will release. So what I'm saying here is, it all depends on whether you are doing or professionally. If you feel that an athlete has to clear and you use it, then there is no ethics in that. Mm-hmm. It's just that I guess you perform.
But is it necessary that, for example, when we had physicians come in the league, from the Nordics, they had told us about applying ice as soon as the injury happens and not using the magic spray as soon as we wanted to know what's the science. Of course, ice swells, reduces the heat and swell and all this stuff. But we wanted to know whether it's first to put the ice on and then put the spray on, or first put on the ice.
The treatment of any injury is simple. Rice, anybody of us can remember that. It's rest, ice, elevation, and compression. RIC, a compression elevation, in that order. Now, this question about spray dalaneta ke ice dalaneta is a non starter. What does the spray do? I tell you scientifically. Your back is hurting, and your.
Suits.
Sorry, I'm late.
By putting the spray, it's an irritant. It's got capsaicin, which is mirchan's extract, actually speaking. It is capsaicin. The most effective spray is capsaicin. So when you spray, it starts burning. The nerve which supplies the underlying joint and the overlying skin are the same. Now this is a scientific theory and it works for some reason. It works in you also. When I spray this part, the nerve endings start burning or tingling so much that the pain impulse is going to the brain, overwhelm under gate theory. The gate block karta. So the pain going from the joint is blocked. This is actually called gate theory. So you do apply the spray, but mind you, it's a symptomatic relief. It's not cure, it's not treatment. Coming to doctor, whatever he said is that you should rest. I totally accept. But I have seen professional athletes, especially in the USA. I was in the NYU as well for some time. Footballers have been injecting steroids on the field. Now, I can understand another side of it. Because what might be happening is that this is a final match for them. It's like Dangal Mati, Shevatchi match. And I just have to win. I just don't care what happens to me any longer. And in those athletes, they do inject cortisone and they do all sorts of things. Provided there is no fracture, there is no dislocation, there is no ligament break, then you can do that as a temporary feature. It's not recommended. Okay, so that answers your question.
Absolutely, sir, that's very good input. So, during normally, when you talk about a sporting event at a grassroots level, we see that most of the events don't have that much medical support. And we ask them, they say it's costly to put up medical support, get in a doctor. But on a very bare minimum, what are the requirements that a sporting event needs to have? Say, at least have one doctor on board, or maybe you have to have another. So whatever, what is a bare minimum that, you know, we can tell sporting events that our main partner is not on board, because this is necessary.
A doctor being on the spot is actually ideal. But it is an expensive proposition. If I am going to spend my entire day at a sporting event, I will say, "Meko 10,000 rupees, so I will come." If you are charging, I will charge. Say simple as it is. If you are doing it free, I might come free.
Correct.
Number one. Number two, now all clubs or even fledgling clubs cannot afford that. So the next best thing would be to have a physiotherapist or an intern who is just passed away. Apart from that, you need a basic kit to be ready at the site of the injury on a football field. Every club needs that.
Medical kit.
The medical kit.
Correct.
Again, as I said, you need an ice patch. You need ice pack. I would use the spray because there is nothing wrong in using the spray. There is nothing in that spray. But it does make the athlete feel a lot better. Okay? And thirdly, I would use a crepe bandage or I would keep compression dressing. Number four, I would keep basic cluster ready, and at least you can train one of your own boys. If you have mood like that, you can use a rough plaster. So, you can use a footpatti, you can use a gawa.
Correct.
Absolutely. So, plasters, bandages, small things, and a paracetamol or some safe tablet which is available over the counter. The next step would be to take him to a medical facility. Yes. If you are suspecting anything more, if after 10 minutes the child just goes up and starts playing and says, I'm okay, which happens to most of us. 90% of the injuries are like that. Then we leave it out. So this ice hand spray normally do the trick, and a paracetamol or something, you know, over the counter, which is safe. And you have to look at the child or the adult, so depending on that, you have to calculate the risk.
When it comes to, for example, a long-term injury that puts a player out or an athlete out in terms of an ACL, something that is a long-term injury, what are normally the phases of recovery before he comes back onto the field in terms of, you know, the rest period, in terms of what does he need to do, how does he come back on?
I will talk about ACL only because it's a common injury.
Exactly.
Or a fracture, which, see, all of them take about 6 to 8 weeks to recover. You make no mistake. Fracture, plaster, 8 weeks, in some cases ankle matches, 3 months. Or any major injury in the lower limb, which restrict our activity, 3 months. I come to specifically ACL. The basic treatment would be still rise, rest, ice, compression, elevation, still.
Okay.
Then having done the investigation, we find there is an ACL, we get operated. Now there are phases of rehabilitation. You know, first 3 weeks, then 3 weeks, 3 weeks, 3 weeks. So normally for the athlete to run again would take a minimum of 3 months. So the first week, 2 weeks would be just range of movement. very so stiff. Just made 2 or 3 weeks to get complete flexion, complete range of movement. Then the number 2 is starting building up of the quadriceps, hamstring,
okay.
The BMO exercises as we call it. The vastus medial is obliquus. Along with that, you have to condition the entire lower leg. You are just focusing on the knee. That is not the issue. When the third phase comes, where the patient starts walking, the knee is now stable, but the patient feels ki ata nigdane gurda saltana jine utartana chadtana, very common. For that, you need what you may call as skateboard exercises. So if you are on the slippery slope and apply one pass around, how we stabilize ourselves instantly. Now that the athlete or the patient for that matter needs to get accustomed to. So you know 3 to 4 weeks. 3 months, 3 months after, and to start putting weight again, and as I said, ACL ligament reconstruct will happen. We are taking ligament out from somewhere and putting it there. Artificial ligaments have gone out, they have failed, all of them. So normally the hamstrings are used as the ACL. The first few weeks are very vulnerable because the new ligament is trying to bond to bone. This is a difficult operation. So first few weeks, 6 weeks, no heroism. After 6 weeks, then intense rehabilitation starts generally 3 months. Simple ankle fractures. After that, the patient comes out of plaster, starts putting some weight on it, and what we call as graded weight bearing. As that, because now, after 6 weeks, unless you put weight, the bone will not heal. For the first few weeks, you don't want the bone to move at all, so you're not putting any weight on it. After some time, the stress going across the bone starts healing up the bone. Hence the graded. If you have to put it, you can put it. But if you have to exercise, you can put it in 3 months.
Okay. But
that's
sometimes they can come back into sports once, maybe after 3 months or 6 months.
How motivated they are.
Right.
Motivated patient will do it. They will get movement in 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Demotivated patient might take 9 months.
Take question.
Or never get back.
So
yeah.
Sometimes.
I mean, on this, Dr. Avishkar, how difficult it's been to. I mean, there are people who come with injury, they're psychologically demotivated. So, you also need to play a role of a psychologist sometimes in terms of, you know, telling them the injury is not so huge, you can recover, you'll get back to your sport, because we need, it is an athlete. For him, it's his bread and butter, or at least not the bread and butter, but a lot of passion attached to the sport. So, how do you convince your patient psychologically that, you know, just to give him that confidence in terms of, you know, he will recover from the injury? Of course, you will be treating him on the medical aspect, but when it comes to the mental aspect, how do you do that?
See, here you rightly said that a doctor is a role of a counselor also. So, taking part in the event, if it is very important for him, then might have increases.
Right.
But apart from this, non-pharmacological treatments, like you can give him yoga, you can make him do your meditation, and more importantly is diet. See, as I said, he is demotivated at any time, but he is motivated. You know, there are many wrong things which are there on the net, and people, it is very easy now to just go on Google and type. And people come up with a diagnosis to a doctor. So that is more wrong. Okay, so you should be informed well. So you should either go to a doctor only. Like I see, people, if they are not even getting sleep, you go to a medical and they can tell this pharmacist that will give me a medicine for that. So that is wrong. So answering your question, you have to have those counseling skills, and that comes with time. Okay, so if you ask me, I tell them to do first, I'm a yoga teacher, so I tell them yogic asanas, meditation, and like as sir said, the exercises, I am focused more on exercises, okay? If whichever he can do, if he's injured his knee, so whichever exercise he can do, like I sir said Surya Namaskar, that is a part of my regime, so I also do the Surya Namaskar, because the exercises which are there in the gym, I really don't believe in them. I believe there is something called Pracha Vidya, okay? And Shri Krishna Bhagavan Balaram had discovered that Pracha Vidya, and you have those Surya Namaskar, Zor, Vaitak, and all these, and all kinds of our Buddhigal Astam, Lord Haske. And all these Vidyas, like you have Kusti. Kusti is also a part of it. So you know, you should promote such things which can be done at home rather than going to the gym. Because what happens in the gym is you do a 3-month course in Gold Gym or any other gym. I am not against any particular gym. You do a 3-month course, have a 12th pass or a 10th pass, you may go to the gym instructor and he will guide you exercises.
And steroids.
Yes, and steroids. The worst part is that a very well-known surgeon had advised a very well-known surgeon, he's treated a very big cricketer. So he had advised exercise to a guy who was actually, you run and then you jump.
He had an injury
here. And he would advise to do some exercise by that physiotherapist of that doctor. And one of my colleagues, he's a national level world cup player, he saw him doing that. So since he went on this, he told him, he didn't listen to my mother, what a doctor jumps in the sign left. So he kept on doing it. After that, he was told that you have to get operated. So you know what? Somewhere down the line, having good opinions also, having good, because you know what? Just by, you know, experience matters. And you know, not all people at, frankly speaking, sports medicine study, if you see, there are only, I think Chennai was known as MBA sports medicine, I think somewhere in Punjab. So in India, there are only MBA sports medicine 6 years. And I know two doctors who have done sports medicine, but they are doing GP. So people who are getting trained in sports medicine in India are not using it. GP is one of the
general
practice,
family doctor.
So yeah, I will answer your question.
Absolutely. I mean, in terms, my question again was more towards the mental aspect, and of course we understand that doctors act as a better counselor, as you said, and
here,
and also the right advice matters.
Here I use my science, that's the, I use homeopathy, so it acts more on your mind, so I give homeopathy medicines. So it will be tough to explain what happens after you medicine, so I use homeopathy.
Yoga and meditation, which you mentioned, is absolutely vital. To focus for an athlete who wants to become a professional athlete. For a weekend athlete, you can get away with it. For a professional athlete, you need it. And, sorry, have I got time?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we have been
ready much. I think the personality of a doctor. I mean, I remember when my father is a surgeon. But still for other things, pediatrician or you know, other things, I remember going to a doctor. And the first thing you need to the doctor with a personality. So I am not saying come to me. I am saying a doctor who gives you positive feedback कि ये तुमको हुआ है, ये करना पड़ेगा, लेकिन ये 100% नहीं, लेकिन ये ठीक हो जाएगा. Unless there is something contrary to that, though I mean we can't cure everything, but seriously. But a doctor who exudes the confidence ना, ये fix करेंगे इसको, ये हो जाएगा. Please correct me if I'm wrong. And I think half the patients were smiling out of your OPD. I think I feel good talking. Half the cure is 50% of the cure is already done there. Yes. And the rest, one thing is confident that follow up with you. But I agree with what you said. You need to go to the right doctor. A lot of people will just do this, do that.
Sir,
you will hang around and then come back and
call you. Sir said that when you go to a doctor, he's half cured. He said a vending in case is half cured. So to go to a right doctor after
half of the
it's cured.
Because so a bad doctor can really make your life miserable.
Right.
It's like, I remember going to the dentist. I don't talk about that.
It's very difficult to identify.
If you don't want to talk about that, you don't want to talk about that. So, you know, you need to go to a doctor who will treat you. What is correct for that diagnosis and condition? And it's quite difficult, believe me. Even if I have to think of referring somebody to some doctor, even I have to think 10 times. So that's how difficult it is.
Alright, Vishesh. Yeah, thank you. So, two more questions on the front. Of course, one of the questions is a very popular question. We had, was one of the great cricketers who suffered from that injury. But we don't know what exactly that injury means.
Tennis elbow.
And tennis elbow, as you rightly said. So we just wanted to know what exactly is a tennis elbow and how is it? And is it because of playing tennis is what got people
thinking. I was going to ask the same question.
See, generically, tennis elbow manje pain on the outer side of the elbow.
Yeah.
Lateral epicondylus. The two epicondyles. From here you get the muscles which go down your fingers and you straighten them. From this side you get tendons which allow you to do this. Now in medical terminology, both of them are called tennis elbows. Like golfer's elbow manta, there are tennis elbow.
Okay.
Just to be more succinct about it, but it is immaterial. This is the most common. The common symptoms are that me kathri vajan uchala or repetitive movement me kathri khele. For example, commonly seen in computer operators. Or who are doing unaccustomed triceps. Sometimes for no apparent reason. Nobody knows how it comes out. Anyone finds that it starts hurting and it just becomes the pain of life. The common symptoms are pain here, but pain which is worsened on doing this against resistance. Okay? Because the moment you do this, it starts hurting here. Now the pathology is that these fibers which come from here, you are suffering from,
I do.
You do as well. Okay. For muscle fibers which are attached here and which go to the extensor tendon, which become the extensor tendon, the muscles here. What we call it micro tears, just a broad insertion of the fan shaped insertion. Okay, the so broad insertions. That the fibers start breaking down. A few fibers break down. It is not a serious problem in view of the severity of the medical issue. It's not cancer, but it is so irritating.
Mm-hmm.
It is seriously irritating. That is the problem. So it's not serious, but it's seriously
irritating.
Now, how do we get this to heal? Again, the first tenet is still rest, ice. If you're doing anything repetitive, avoid it. Now, everybody cannot avoid going to work or sweeping the floor. There is a lot of housemaid also getting, that's the reason I said sweeping the floor. But if you can rest for a few days, it certainly works. Number two is still ice application twice a day. Number three is that gel or the spray which you mentioned. You want to massage it in a tangential plane to the muscle fibers. The muscle fibers are running like this. You need to massage it horizontally, a centimeter below that bone. By doing that, you are trying to stimulate blood supply and you are trying to bring more blood into that area so that the micro tears heal. And the number four is there are few medicines which are specific for tennis elbows and those kind of things, like heel pain, for example, plantar fasciitis. They are grouped under tendinopathies loosely. The 100 types of tendinopathies, but there are one or few drugs which are specific to those. But they can be only given on prescription. Having said that, sometimes the physio can help you by doing local ultrasound. Again, the idea of all these modalities is to increase the blood supply. Commonly seen, apart from those where we don't know the cause, either repetitive or lifting or whatever, sometimes there is no cause which we can discover from the history. But it is also the other, let's say 40-50% of the patients, tennis elbow commonly seen in diabetics, in rheumatoid arthritis, in gout, in hypothyroidism, pregnancy. These are the common conditions where it is commonly seen. So if the tennis elbow is not getting relieved by simple measures, then I will investigate for disease process. Or if somebody has not checked their sugar for a long time, I will say still check it anyway once a year. So these are the common tests done. Then we apply tennis elbow brace. The brace stops the basically the brace level the kaya hota rahe. No, no, it stops the muscle from expanding to full capacity. That is the rationale of why we do this. So I'm gripping something, when I grip, the muscle expands. Contract length madhe hota hai, but body madhe expand hota hai. So when it expands, I stop the expansion by a tight fitting tennis elbow brace. So that the excursions here are minimum. That's actually the theory of it. Seems to work, whatever it is. Nothing works, then we go for cortisone injection, barbotach. Barbotach means actually needles in local madhe holes karavi lagtat bones madhe. It sounds quite drastic, but it is not. It's actually a OPD procedure. It takes 5, 7, 10 minutes maybe. And that again, the idea being exactly the same, to stimulate bony healing by causing bleeding. So accurately, these are said that thoda kaalane hoi ikde, manje vahila paije. Taras te bone bandha bleeding jhala hai, ta absent paije. Otherwise, it does not work. If still does not work, then surgery is the answer And for some reason, surgery for tennis elbow works very well. For arthrocanthinopathy, it does not work well, quite well. But for tennis elbow, supposedly it works quite well. And I have done a few as well, and they are, you know, they speak quite well. So these are the common problems, are the signs and symptoms of tennis elbow. And this is the way we normally go about it. Conservative, injection, then surgery.
Already feeling relieved.
Because of personality.
coming to something, for example, we see in our academy many parents who come in and talk about two things. When it comes to young kids, about how to grow height, and what could be the right exercises to grow height, which sport do you play if you want to grow height. And second thing, what is the essential diet, you know, content in terms of how much protein should they have, how much vitamin should they have in their diet, what should be the right things that they need to have, the fat content and all those things. So, what would you advise a 10-year-old who plays a sport and maybe he's got a height of around 5 or 4 8 or something like that, and how could he grow height at the same time in terms of what could be his diet content when he plays, for example, a sport like football or maybe even athletics for that.
Two things I would advise is avoid a sugar which is called sucrose, what you use every day. See, not many people might know this, but sucrose is made up of glucose plus fructose. Okay? Glucose is used up in your body. Fructose is a very bad metabolism, it is stored in the liver. So when you are using sucrose, you are like any sugar which you are using is sucrose. You put sugar in this tea and coffee, that is sucrose. So glucose is being used up. So for every 1 gram of sucrose, you have 1 gram. You have divided 2.5 grams of glucose, 0.5 grams of fructose. That glucose is used up in the body. Because glucose is the only sugar which is used up in the body. Fructose is used up. So you imagine how much amount of sucrose you are using. Okay, and that goes on getting stored in the liver. And nowadays, what children are facing is the main problem is obesity. Earlier, children were not obese. You see, patterns of eating have gone from poli bhaji to burger. We have a McDonald's here. Everyone against it, of course, but the number of eateries which are coming of fast food has become more of a rage rather than a need. Okay? How many children, for a 10-year-old, you ask a 10-year-old what he will like? He will not like pohe and chia. He will prefer a burger or a sandwich. So, first of all, you should change his diet completely. In terms of sugar, you avoid sugar. Now you will ask me, sir, why should you can replace the sugar. You have another sugar called dextrose. That is glucose plus glucose. So that is a less sweet. It's less sweet, you have to use it more. But it is only glucose. So it is something which
will
use
brown sugar?
No. Brown sugar is again another name for sucrose. There are many other trade names for sucrose. This is only dextrose. You go to a medical shop, you tell it dextrose, it's a white color sugar. If you put 1 gram of sucrose, maybe you will have to put 5-6 grams of dextrose, but it is glucose, so it will be used up in the body. It's just like what is going in should come out.
Okay.
So the first thing I would advise him is stop that sucrose. The second thing is like improve his diet. Complete improvement. If you have to play at a higher level, you have to have that kind of physique. And thanks to Siddharth, we had I examined 55 footballers from the league. And none of them, I believe, were fit. They all had gym, toned bodies and all. The main issue in a football player is you should have a good calf muscle. All of them had weak calf muscles. None of them had good calf muscles. Even if you made them do exercises and that, their flexibility is not good. So, I don't know why this is happening. Maybe lack of training or maybe lack of
knowledge at a younger level. Because most of them who keep playing just keep playing without, you know, they don't feel, they go only to a doctor when there is a problem, not otherwise. That's what I feel.
You don't have proactive access to a sports physician.
Correct.
Proactive before you start training.
Here is the field where it's called preventive medicine. Sir. In our country, again, MDs, preventive medicine, you would see preventive medicine clinics in big hospitals. Like I would say, there is no clinic in Jupiter, no preventive medicine. Like there is no sports medicine clinic in big hospitals. Even if you go to Selfie, the sports medicine clinic is there, you know, who will be there? A physiotherapist will be there on call. So, people are not aware that you can have injury without, you know, you can be sick without going to a doctor. That is the first thing. People go to a doctor only after falling sick. I would say here it is not the problem of the doctor. The doctor is always there to give services. It is the problem of motivation, the problem of knowledge. So the more we make people aware that you need to go to a doctor. I'm not saying this because I'm a doctor, I need to run my house. It is because you should be aware. There are so many silent diseases which are coming up. Like, you know, I'm going on the topic sometime, but this is what I would advise.
Correct.
That's it.
So in terms of when it comes to the height and exercises, what would be?
I'll tell you what I did. So basically cycling.
Okay.
That's all.
Cycling as well as the process.
I'm not aware. Okay. I'll tell you what I did. So I know what I measured. Sorry.
Should I mention something on that?
Yeah, absolutely.
No, this is anecdotal. I will.
Yeah.
I am not. I mean, he has obviously done his research.
Okay.
I can tell you only from myself and from whom I have evidence.
Yeah.
Whole grains. We are all aware.
Okay.
Should be a high content of whole grains, green leafy vegetables and eggs. Like my parents are 100% vegetarian. So eggs khaiche mhanje chorun ka jari khaiche kiwa bahar ka jari khaiche. Eggs are the first class proteins, and unfortunately, I mean we like it or not, vegetarian diet apart from nachini is not first class protein. Eggs and meat are first class proteins. Let's face the fact. So an athlete who is serious about achieving something needs to go on that diet. Okay? Keeping the family sensitivity apart. You cannot have everything. Number two, I will say that, you know what cycling you mentioned, I will say pull-ups.
Pull-ups
seem to work. And for some reason, biscuits seem to work.
Okay.
For growing height. See, you have to remember that the height of the child depends on the height of the parents.
Mm-hmm.
My parents are, you know, my father is 5'7", maybe 5'8". My father is 5'3". The typical Indian algorithm. And I am 6'0.5".
Mm-hmm.
So I made sure I am not adopted. and then I was younger. So they said, you eat a lot of bread and biscuits. I do not recommend it. Let me underline myself. And if I asked my mother, he said, you used to eat a whole loaf of bread in one sitting. I am not proud of it, but it seems to work in some way. But I am not recommending it. It is just anecdotal. Again, please add to this.
Again, we had a point here about sucrose. When it comes to energy drinks, and people play, as soon as the match gets over, you get a Gatorade or you drink an Energizer. So, I mean, of course, energy drinks have their own science behind it in terms of replenishing energy, but as such, would you recommend an energy drink as a necessity, or is just water sufficient enough to hydrate you after the match?
It's not a necessity, for sure. As the brands would make you believe otherwise. Certainly not required. Ordinary limbato sarbat works equally well or better. Now, what that does not have, I tell you, it does not have high caffeine content, which is there in a lot of energy drinks, like for example, Red Bull. It works, and make no mistake, Red Bull and other energy drinks work. Monster and, you know, there are 3-4 brands in the market. You go to Alpha, you will see 20 brands on the shelf. Now, they work because of the caffeine content. And the caffeine certainly improves your performance. It has already been found scientifically. It improves your concentration, albeit short term. The coffee pehle maine bhi chaat tha abhyas nahi kar chuka. For short term, for that matter, again, this I mentioned as anecdotal, not to be mentioned, not to be used. Even smoking increases your concentration and short term performance. Obviously, in the long run, smoking is completely out. So none of these drinks are essential if you have good hydration and electrolytes. What is electrolytes? Sodium, potassium, limbu and imbiri. What we use for oral rehydration solution, ORS. As doctor recommended, if we can replace the sugar by dextrose, that would be beneficial. Occasionally, if you are a high performance athlete between the matches, you need to have that motivation to keep going. It's not just replenishing my water. I need that here. And that's where the caffeine kicks in.
What about banana?
Banana is power packing. But I would not have it does not have a place in the instant hydration or electrolyte balance.
But yes. During the practice sessions and all, if the...
It is a high potassium product.
So
for people who get cramps,
for them it is
recommended.
What we see is tennis players in the break.
They always eat banana.
You can have electoral powder. Ordinary electoral powder, 2 tablespoons in water.
Okay.
Is equal to limbu sarbat.
Okay.
Without the, you know, completely strong taste of limbu sarbat. You like that? But I think caffeine has a place in the high performance professional athletes. I don't think children should be subjected to that. In the long term, there are deleterious effects because it is an addicting drink. But otherwise, it works very well, and for the professional athlete, I would recommend.
You talked about proteins just now and coming to something which everybody knows about.
Since you said proteins, like sir said our proteins, there is a very easy way, like people who do bodybuilding, they are advised 1.5 grams per kilo body weight for the protein. Like if ideally I would go about 120 to 130 grams every day. So people will calculate it that way, like one egg has 3.5 grams of protein. So if I want to increase 100 grams of protein, I'll have to eat more than 30, which is not possible. Okay, so there are many alternatives for that. Like the most nicest alternative is if you are a non-vegetarian. Okay, mobile asa, sukha mobile asa. 100 grams sukha mobile mode 36 grams protein asa. Par tumhi ते अशे भरपूर ऑल्टरनेटिव्ह आहेत. तुम्ही तुम्ही असे भरपूर ऑल्टरनेटिव्ह तुम्ही आर एन डी करून स्वतःसाठी करू शकता. हे फक्त मी खातो म्हणून मी सांगू शकतो.
But athletes are taking, they are eating up to 15-15 eggs a day. Now, some of my friends are doing it. They are bodybuilders and some of them are power champions, they are state level power champion athletes. And they are eating 15-15. Now, the problem is eating protein, you know, 15 eggs, 20 eggs. Number one, it's difficult to sustain.
Yes.
After few days, you start getting bored of eggs and you don't want to see them again. And the number two, if you don't hydrate, it damages your kidneys badly. So unless you are drinking 5 liters of water along with 15 eggs, that is fine. But if you are not drinking water and only eating 15 eggs, it will just clog up your kidneys very.
Same goes for protein.
What about paneer as a protein?
There is a good food product. Limitation.
What is that? Limitation means?
Because paneer is high fat content also.
Okay.
So, but it has got good protein, you are right. And it is recommended for recovery of patients.
Mm-hmm.
So paneer is a good food product in moderation. I mean, paneer I would recommend as some supplement.
Right.
So you are asking something.
Yeah, so are these protein shakes and powders any good? I personally feel they are not.
What he also mentioned, I will add to that. There are the protein shakes in the market. I will forget about the protein shakes. I will talk about the protein powders. Protein powders you put in milk, it is protein shake. Mm-hmm. Or you put it in water. Mm-hmm. Now our requirements, as you rightly said, are 100 to 120 grams a day, which you can never hope to match. We are all, you know, let's say for example, we are not professional athletes at the moment. But people who are training to be that, or training to be high performance, need that 100 grams. Or at least you should be reaching 80 grams. And again, it is impossible to do that. You can eat 3-4 eggs a day. Where does the rest of the protein come from? You might be eating chicken, you might be eating nachne, you might be eating you know, some other non-vegetarian, as you mentioned. Kiti protein brain are there, Chapna? That is where the protein powders come in. Each tablespoon full of powder, if you look at the ingredients, it will say each tablespoon has 7 grams or 8 grams. The high protein content, and they work.
Protein
is for muscle, hydration is for that thing to reach the muscle in the first place.
The proteins, I mean, in terms when they when you go to a gym normally, instead of concentrating on the gym work, they normally tell you you should have a protein because your body, of course, as you said, they are not doctors at the end of the day, but in terms of, you know, just saying for increasing muscle, for example, somebody who's having a lean body shape. And they say that you have to take protein powder in order to grow muscles. There's no way you want to do a gym training session and increase muscles. So
whey protein.
What is the age they should start? Or should they start at all in children?
No, they have a place. See, these are all products which are geared to. Again, I will come back to professional athletes.
Yes.
It is not for you and me.
Perfect.
Okay. If you want to do powerlifting, yes, you must take it. Now the problem with that whey protein, the whey protein you need to hydrate. Whey protein lodges in the kidneys so fast that you don't hydrate and you carry on with that cycle, you will start having kidney failure at some point. If you don't hydrate, again,
hydration.
5 liter water, whey protein to make it. Because you are doing that kind of exercise, I think. During power lifting, then you need 5 liters of water.
I just want to make an input. This is not written in the books, but if you recent factual data, you can Google it out. Google Scholars is a much more place where you can get research out. You know? So more of protein powders has led to decrease in the sperm count. It means it has caused a lot of this thing, you know, in people just want infertility. So this field, this kind of research is recently coming up, but it is not allowed to come out. If it comes out, their market will go down. So if you ask me on a personal basis, one-to-one basis, I tell all people I know, or even I was, whenever I used to exercise, or as an athlete, I used to always, I stayed away from these. Because it is not written in the books, but I don't know why it is not covered in the books, but many senior doctors that close to me have told me that we should not take for it will lead, in the long run, it will lead to infertility. There is no quotation in any standard book about this, but there is research data there.
I'm sorry, I haven't come across this.
Yeah, yeah,
obviously, I'm ignorant on that front.
It's not in the books.
I agree. No, but forget about the medical book, ordinary medical books, it's not there even in sports medicine books. But the whey protein, as you said, it bulks your frame up. So what happens when you stop taking them? Or what happens when you stop exercising? For what you are taking that in the first place, it starts getting converted to adipose tissue. You know how long it takes for you to stop exercising and your muscles to start becoming flabby? 2 weeks.
Oh,
that's all.
Two weeks.
Only.
So outside you might look bulky and rounded, but your muscles have started to already convert to adipose tissue. Not muscles converting, it's not. It's like a medicine muscle, that's a directly convert them. But storage, it starts gradually being replaced by adipose tissue. Fat. So anybody who is not sustaining that type of activity, who is not hydrating well, and who is not, who is taking the amounts in bulk which exceeds the normal body requirement, there is a per kg body weight requirement when you are doing those specific activities. Apart from the cosmetic result which you get from whey protein, there is nothing much to recommend it. If you are a serious gym person, you are interested in bodybuilding, yes, that is for you. But for ordinary athletes, if somebody is playing football, do you want whey protein? No, because it's going to bulk them up. You don't want the bulky frame, you want actually a lighter frame.
Yes.
That will reduce their mobility, in fact. And typically, upper body is just the same.
Thank you so much, sir. We will open it up for questions.